Right. Thank you for your address, first of all. Now, one small question. You mentioned the Don Carson in relation to Fourth Commandment. Can you shed a little bit more light about it? I never heard about it.
Yes, this is an increasingly popular view within evangelicalism, so it's much wider than the new Calvinism, that the church, basically, and I'm not going to present specifically Carson's view, but the general view, so I mean, if he was listening in, although I think he's probably a bigger fish to fry, I'll give you the general view, the church basically fixed the first day of the week. Not God by raising his son on the first day, not pouring out the Holy Spirit on the first day in Pentecost, not Christ appeared to the disciples. The church did that, and it's a good idea, because we need a day. And there are reasons why the church picked it and so forth, and it has worked pretty well. Then you can go to church, and that's good. Yeah, you should go to church, and it's even better if you can go twice, And then the rest of the day, kind of up to you. I mean, it's not the Westminster Confession, the Westminster Shorter Catechism treatment of the Fourth Commandment. And then the difficulty is, once you begin to do that, then you're going to weaken the church's role in the lives of people. You're going to weaken their own sanctification and keeping that day holy. And then, as a Christian minister, we need in our church two sermons and two worship services every day to keep the whole thing together by the grace of God. And you need people keeping that commandment, with Ezekiel especially, though he's talking about the Old Testament, form of the Sabbath, which is the seventh day, speaks about, in terms of sanctification, I am the Lord who sanctifies, keep my Sabbath day, I am the Lord who sanctifies you. And we keep that day holy, and God sanctifies us as we keep that day holy.
That's a little bit Catholic, like, you see, tradition is superior to the word of God here, and this is what they use.
Yes, and it can easily degenerate that whole view, sort of once and then you're off to the beach.
Yeah. You mentioned some healers, they could do miracles sometimes, not other people. And the apostles, when they couldn't do miracles, Jesus stepped in.
Yes.
But Jesus couldn't do miracles in Nazareth, or I could only do a few healings there.
Yes, that's an interesting point. Jesus, I think even the text does say, couldn't do many miracles there because they didn't believe. But what Jesus did was, Jesus didn't actually come to somebody who didn't have miraculous faith. If there was somebody there who wanted nothing to do with them, say a dyed-in-the-wool Pharisee, Jesus wouldn't come over and heal them. He healed believers who specifically asked him. But not everybody who asked him or saw his healing was a true believer. The classic example in Luke 17, I think it is, of the 10 lepers, and only one came back to thank him. But the ones who were healed, they had, the technical word, I'm sure you're aware, is miraculous faith. They saw Jesus heal people, and they thought, well, look, this man heals people. He has the ability to heal me. You don't need to be saved. I mean, there were Egyptians who saw Moses' plagues, and they could work out that, see, after Moses did the first seven plagues by the power of God, that when he said this eighth one was coming, that it was going to come. But you didn't need to see that. So Jesus healed all those people. And whenever Jesus didn't heal in Nazareth, he comes into Nazareth, he's a normal part of his ministry. These people in Nazareth so hated him. I mean, they went to push him off the cliff in Luke chapter 4. Yeah. That even though they knew fine well, I mean, everybody in the area knew fine well they did miracles, they hated them that much they didn't even want to heal them. I mean, I know there are many unbelievers who hate Jesus Christ, and if there really was some healing, if God really was healing, they'd swallow their pride a bit, and they would say, here, I hate the whole movement, but boy, I lost my left leg in a car accident, I'd love another one, But the people in Nazareth, they were so hardened. So that's my answer. She was a lot of hatred, though.
To the point about the desire of God. So,
sorry?
The desire of all. In Paul's writing to Timothy, he said, God desires all men to come to repentance.
Oh, yes, yes.
He said God doesn't try and fail. So then there's a difference between the word try and the word desire. So God desires all men to come to repentance. He doesn't try to fail.
Okay, there's a couple of things. If I, let me see, I'm trying to think of something that I would desire. Let's say, if I said I desire to watch, I live in Northern Ireland, if I said I desire to watch Ballymena United, a football team, play on Saturday, and then I lay in bed, well, making it really clear, well, to 4 o'clock in the afternoon, it's quite a lie in here, you know, didn't buy a ticket, didn't get in my car, and then when it came at 4 o'clock, I went and had a shower or something, and you know, then you'd say, you know, but you said you wanted to, but the word, the adverbs that go with desire are sincerely, passionately. So God sincerely, earnestly, passionately wants to save everybody. That's the classic position. That's John Murray or John Piper. And John Piper, I mean, if anybody has ever used in the history of the Christian church the word passion, that's the cover. I mean, he is a passionate guy. He is, I mean, you know, he's all into it and so forth. Very passionate. So in his presentation, he especially emphasizes the passion of it. But we'll come to 1 Timothy 2 in a minute. If I said I wanted to go to watch Ballymena, that would involve getting out of bed at the appropriate time, or we'd hope you'd be up before 3 p.m., getting your breakfast, buying the ticket, maybe if you've got a scarf, you know, putting the scarf on and driving the right direction in your car. But if I didn't do any of those things, you wouldn't really say the man really desired. Well, God is said to desire the salvation of everybody. But what's involved in salvation? Right? Well, the first step is before the foundation of the world. We're chosen Jesus Christ. So God, instead of electing that person, ordains them to destruction in the way of their sins. That doesn't look very much like... And then there's the cross, the procurement of our salvation. And Jesus lays down his life for the sheep, and he tells other people, you're not my sheep, I didn't die for you. And then the first stage of the application of salvation is regeneration. But John 3 verse 8 says, the Spirit blows where it listeth. Or the wind bloweth where it listeth. And listeth is another word for desire. It wants, the wind blows wherever it wants. And you hear the sound, you know where it's coming or where it's going. It's the wind that blows sovereignly. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. I mean, there's times that I, as a minister, especially when you're working with your children in the church or members of your own family, you just wish that you could, I know it's foolish, but you understand, you wish you could channel the Spirit, but the Spirit blows where he listeth. And then you've got the effectual call of the gospel. But huge numbers of people now and in the history of the world, practically all in the Old Testament, apart from the Jews and a few surrounding people, never heard the gospel. You know, so if God really wants to save them, and again, I can say this because I don't believe this, and because of, you know, irreverent issues, I'm trying to press home the point that this doesn't make sense. He's actually not trying very hard. He's not really making a great job of it. And then you see, if you desire something, if you really want something and you don't get it, there's disappointment. You know, I really wanted, let's say, to get 3 A's in my A levels. They still call them A levels. They do. Good. Because I want to go to university and I'd like to be a medic. We were talking about this in the car, so that's why that example comes to my mind. And then you don't get them. You say, oh, I wanted to be a medic, but maybe I can do something else in the field of medicine. I'm disappointed. And your mum and dad would probably put their arm around you and say, look, son, it obviously isn't for you. You're a Christian. God's directing you here. There are other things in life. God has a purpose for you in some other area. Now, if you really passionately, earnestly want something, then there's disappointment. Then there's in a certain sense, failure. So, and then you see, you've got Psalm 115, verse 3. Our God is in the heavens.
He hath done
whatsoever he hath pleased. And the point of that psalm is, you know, a God, it's actually these with their gods are silver and gold, they can't do these things. But our God's in the heavens. Once you're a God in the heaven, he does whatever he pleases, because everything is created by God. Without him, says John 1, Jesus, was nothing made that was made. And then God's providence, without God, there's nothing that moves or lives or has its being, Acts 17. And God's creation and providence are all under his complete and absolute sovereignty. So everything that's created, every movement, every moment of the entire universe. And then if that God wants anything, that happens. Because our God is in the heavens. He hath done whatsoever he pleased. There's an exact correspondence. There's never any failure. And it's interesting that that passage was the one that Augustine especially used in the early church, because the Pelagians and the semi-Pelagians had this idea, something like Arminians in the 17th century, had this idea that, you know, God loved everybody and wanted to save them. And Augustine said, no, our God is in the heavens. He hath done whatsoever he hath pleased. And it's interesting, the Roman Catholic Church today even yet calls Augustine the doctor of grace. I mean, I don't disbelieve in grace, but here's the doctrine of grace. You know, because Rome, I mean, if you ever read the Catechism of the Catholic Church, you ought to see, but our service we call it the well-meant offer, you ought to see the emphasis that's put in there. God loves everybody. God wants to save everybody. It is massive throughout the whole document. It's one of those things, I'm sure you've got some too, that you, I'm always going to get round to doing it, but then there's something else comes up. Then in the 9th century, there was a man called Gottschalk, and he rotted in jail for 19 years because he believed in the absolute sovereignty of God. And they said to him, you know, you can get out. Just toe the line. Don't preach that God is absolutely sovereign. And we've got a lot of his documents that were published just a few years ago. And Gottschalk was an Augustinian, and he said, no, our God is in the heavens, he's done what service he pleased, I'm not going to budge. And so they kept him under house arrest for 19 years. I could tell you about Fulgentius of Rust, one of Mary's favourites, in the 6th century. This is the teaching of the absolute sovereignty of God, and it's dead right. But anyway, first, let's come to the verse itself. 1 Timothy 2, verse 4. 1 Timothy 2, verse 4. We'll read the opening verses. I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Saviour, who will have all men to be saved, and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God, and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all, to be testified in due time. If we take in verse 4 all men to mean all men head for head, guess what verse 6 logically must teach? Does anybody tell me? It must teach logically universal atonement. Verse 4 says, God will have all men be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. For there's one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself for all to be testified in due time. So my first response, maybe a bit more, I'm going to clear it up. But first response is, if we take verse 4 to be all men, everybody head for head, we're into universal atonement. And in all the discussions I've had with people who, you know, sorry, I don't know your name, I don't want to be too short. I'm not going to talk about you, because we've only just met tonight. This means Tim, you know, not one of them, I've never been able to get one of them to admit that if you go that well-known way of verse 4, you have to teach universal atonement, because it's the same all. It's the same all men.
Well, you know, different words of Greek for all.
Let's just pass. Yeah. You know, if you take all men,
the meaning can be, you know, varied in a way.
Yes, but you see that the argument in verse 1, God will have all men to be saved. If the all men there means every individual man who ever lived to be saved, come to knowledge, for here's the reason there's only is one, there's one God, there's one mediator between men. This mediator gave himself for all. So you end up with universal atonement. So this is isolated from the rest. Yes, and this is the problem. And then you see, so if you look at verse 4 and you see it's in a context, there's grammatical links here. If you go forward, you see that view means universal atonement, verse 6. Now, the other aspect of the context is the forward context, the backward context. The opening verses, Paul here is, what is he doing? He's talking to Timothy about prayers of the pastor in the church. I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. But it's not all men, mean every individual person on the planet.
Yeah.
We're going to have incredibly long congregational prayers. Our children are not going to be impressed. And then it goes on to say, for all men, for kings, and for all that are in authority. So you pray for them, and you pray for the kings and all that are in authority. Number one, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. You pray for kings, you pray for civil rulers, you pray for parliament, because we want to be able to live a quiet, peaceable life. So we pray that they'll frame laws whereby we can worship, that some of the left-wing radicals won't be able to take our children away from us, or that they're not trying to impinge us preaching what God's word says about marriage between one man and one woman. And then verse 3 adds a second reason. This is good and acceptable in the sight of God, who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. We even pray for these kings and all who are in authority, because God saves all sorts of men. Have you ever thought to yourself, and I'll make a concrete little point, have you ever thought to yourself, what's the point praying for David Cameron or Tony Blair or
Kim Jong-un, in
North Korea? Yes. What's the point? Because God's never going to convert them. And should they all go, you pray for them, and you pray one that God will convert them. Because he will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of truth. And you pray that God will make laws for the good of the church. But you also know that the persecution, as Jesus says in Matthew 24, it's part of the lot, and it intensifies towards the end. So you pray even that with the will of God. And when it says for kings and for all of our authority, we're dealing here with the Catholicity of the church. The Catholicity of the church means that God's going to save people from North Korea or South Korea and Poland and all over. But the Catholicity of the church means people of different ages, and also means people of different ranks, for want of a better word, because though there's not many rich men and mighty men and wise men called, it doesn't say that there's not any. So you pray for them. And by the way, 1 Timothy 2 verse 4, I'm glad you actually mentioned it, is Augustine, Gottschalk. It is the historic passage in this issue's crop up, the historic passage in the issue of the Women Offer. And we have a web page with quotes of people interpreting this the right way. Thomas Watson takes the same view that we're taking. Sorry, Mary? Oh, yes. Yes. Oh, Mary's reminded me. I thought she was saying, look, dear, don't be carried away. Please warm. But she was actually saying, although she's probably thinking that, she's actually saying that this book mentions it. Here are the people who take the view that I just explained in 1 Timothy 2 verse 4. Januarius, Caesarius of Arles, Cassiodorus in the 6th century, an old Irish gloss, Sidulus Scotus, Florus of Lyon, Prudentius of Troy, Servatus Lupus, Rotranus of Corby, I hope you're jotting those down, Ingemar, Remigius of Lyon, Hugh of St. Victor, Peter Lombard, Bonaventure, Thomas Aquinas, Dun Scotus, Thomas Bradwardine, Gregory of Rimini, John Wycliffe, Lorenzo Valla, Martin Bucer, Jerome Zacchaeus, Zacharias Ursinus, Daniel Tassanus, William Ames, Jacobus Triglandus, Thomas Watson, Witsius, De Moor, Van Hernert, De Cock, William Cunningham, Smeaton, Lorraine Boutner, John Robbins, Peter Barnes. And then we also have Augustine, Fulgentius, Gottschalk, Calvin, Knox, Beza, Bridges, Cymodonkeus, Bastinius, Perkins, Dove, Dumoulin, the Geneva Theses, Francis Turton, Gurner, Heidegger, Kuiper, Rainbow, Engelsman, Moore. Anyway, so I'm not alone.
And me.
And Jerzy Sakarias. That's it. Settled. Ingmar.
Yes, I just want to. You mentioned N.T. Wright.
Yes.
Why isn't there a bigger outcry for his new perspectives on Paul and the stuff that he's doing? Because I heard. What's his name? Alistair McGrath saying, look, if N.T. Wright is right, then Martin Luther is wrong.
Yes.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's a serious, obviously, as you mentioned, the Reformation, that's the antithesis of, you know, that is pretty massive.
Oh, it's huge.
Yeah.
N.T. Wright says that justification, a former bishop, where was it? The Northeast
England.
Durham. Bishop of Durham. N.T. Wright says that justification isn't about legal standing of an individual before God. If someone's justified, it means they're included in the church. It's not soteriology, it's not salvation, it's ecclesiology, it's inclusion in the church. And then you say to yourself, it's wonderful, these great scholars and high-ranking people, look at the word justification. The word is all about righteousness, justice, the legal standing before God, being right before Him. And you can say that justification means being included in the people of God. And then he redefines kingdom of God, he redefines gospel, he redefines church. And you know what he ends up with? Those who are justified are members of the visible people of God. He ends up with the Anglican Church. Because you're saved, because you're part of the big corrupt institution. And lo and behold, he's like a magician. He's done jiggling around and he's brought up and he's taught the doctrine of a totally corrupt and false church. And then, I'll speak a little bit from an American perspective on this one, he's a bishop. One of the problems with Protestants, evangelicals, reformed people, whatever name you want to use to it, is that they feel a little bit slighted, belittled. They don't have the big heavyweights, the great institutions, the money, the numbers. And for a number of Americans, especially American evangelicals, well, here's a bishop. Here's a bishop from the Church of England. And he's saying something that sort of sounds a bit like us, and he's actually interacting with our books. So then that must be good. And it's interesting, they said the same thing to Martin Luther. They said, Martin, you've got a few followers, you've got your university in Wittenberg, there's some individuals coming in, you've got some capable scholars, you're producing books, but you haven't got many bishops. You haven't got many bishops. In the most days they hadn't any bishops, and then actually they did get some in sort of Latvia, Lithuania area. But you know, this reminds us of what they said in John's Gospel regarding the Lord Jesus. The common people, you know, but who of the scholars, who of the great religious leaders are following? Therefore, he must be wrong. It's a craven man-centeredness. And that's why it was someone like Martin Luther that God used to bring the Reformation, and not some of these other guys.
When you talk about this business about justification, not to do with a forensic term, you've got it in the New Perspectives with the shepherd and all these people. It does in Westminster. You don't have to go to the Anglican Church. Westminster Seminary.
Yes.
And that, as far as what you're talking about tonight, it's been around for 20 years. The seeds of it have been around. I've been a Christian for 60 years. It's been all that time because it's inevitable. When you're talking about change to the climate of the age, the taste, it's been a development. It's had to come to this because there's been denial of what is true Calvinism as long as I can remember. I mean, even with the Banner of Truth Trust, the man who set it up with him, Norton, left him within a year because he could see even they were getting slack on these principles.
Yes. Yes.
I mean, it's been there throughout. I mean, even as back as far as 1689, the Baptist Confession of Faith, under the influence of Benjamin Keach. They didn't follow the Savoy or the Westminster. They denied reprobation in that.
Yes. That
they, instead of saying ordained to judgment, they say, left to it.
Yes, mm-hmm. And the doctrine of reprobation is ordained and passed over.
Yeah.
You need both.
Yes, it's been a weakening because there's been a rejection of the kingship of Christ in the church. This has been a big problem.
Yes. Yes, it is.
And once there's a rejection of the kingship of Christ, then we have all kinds of problems developing. Because man becomes the authority over all things. And what we've come to today, you could see it quite some time ago, it is inevitable. It's the taste of the day, you appeal to the taste of the day. Because you put a question mark over it, it's not Christian for certainties. It's more like a social club.
Because you know, like John Piper, you know, sometimes also we heard together at our home in Beijing. Some area he's very good as a preacher, isn't he? Explaining gospel and you know, preaching and. So
I mean, just marriage thing.
Yeah, I mean, So, I think that even Dr. Martin Lloyd Jones, even I believe Calvin and Martin Luther was not perfect, wasn't it? So no man. Yeah. Theologian or teacher was perfect, but then as a lay believer like me, so sometimes very difficult. We know like Antirite, yes, he's a complete, he's a false teacher, and you know, not worth to listen. But you know, sometimes some issues like women's role and marriage, and we listen John Piper. I don't listen about Holy Spirit baptism. Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones, but other preachings I listen and learn a lot. So it's very difficult to draw a line, which teacher is really a false teacher. We shouldn't really give even 1 second to listen. But some teachers are like John Piper, Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones, he's very good, but this area. So it's quite very difficult to draw a line.
I appreciate the point. Like somebody with Bishop of Durham, to me that's crystal clear. Other men like Piper, some of the stuff he says is very good, and a discerning Christian to can read that material and look at it.
So what could be your sort of advice, and how can we have sort of a practical guidelines?
Read the bits where he's good. I don't agree with the bits where he's wrong. Yep, that would be the simple one. I mean, in one sentence. But we do need to end. So thanks for your attention. We have some books on the table here, some box sets, and some free pamphlets, and there'll be tea and coffee too.